So this was done in a few years ago. This particular slide, this was a photo taken 5 years ago, actually, at the 30-year celebration. You may see some familiar faces. Anyway, next slide. So, you know, I kind of wish that I could just go through this because it's a little bit, but hopefully you hear me. Okay, so looking back over 35 years, you got to realize Martyn and I started at the same time, okay, doing this program. So that's why we look so good. It's remarkable to see how early research questions and discoveries lay the groundwork for some of today's important environmental health research. This center continues to explore how environmental factors contribute to disease and to create prevention and cleanup strategies that protect human health and the environment. So I'm going to give you a few examples. I hope this is okay. Alan Smith's pioneering work in Chile and Nevada uncovered a high incidence of bladder cancers associated with arsenic exposure. His team later found an association between early life exposures of arsenic and adult mortality. The researchers also provided the first human evidence, of a link between obesity and arsenic. Work by the UC Berkeley SRP Center also showed that arsenic in drinking water poses higher risk of diseases than any other environmental chemical exposure. So with that, I'm now going to talk about some of the research. So the UC Berkeley researchers were pioneers in exposomics and adductomics approaches to exposure science. It has been determined that the SRP is actually is a working model for the exposome, okay? And these technologies fit squarely within that. Exposomics involves the study of all exposures on individual experiences across the lifespan. And adductomics, it measures substances bound to blood proteins. Scientists continue to break new grounds in exposomics research to help explain how disease risk factors interact. The next topic I'm going to mention is near and dear to my heart, which is in children's health. The center's early outreach core, called the Children's Environmental Health Network, promoted children's health through workshops, conferences, training, and resource guides. It also led to the funding of the Children's Environmental Health Work, Environmental Health Centers at NIEHS and EPA, and is also now a standing organization based in Washington, D.C. It is really a credit to Berkeley's flexibility and willingness to take this on that allowed for children's environmental health to now become so much more mainstream than it ever was. With regards to remediation, UC Berkeley multidisciplinary projects are detecting, measuring, and reducing contaminants to hazardous waste sites. For example, Kent Udell demonstrated that steam injection can remove contaminants at hazardous waste sites. The finding led to the first complete cleanup of a Superfund site, which took place in Vista Luna, California. His work also led to the remediation of Alameda Island and other projects here and in Central Eastern Europe, including Lithuania. SRP trainees, Jay James and Jeffrey Cosby, demonstrated the utility of gold nanoparticles to monitor mercury in the environment. The research led to James and Crosby founding the company Picayune. I don't know where they got that name. And funded by the SRP SBIR, it's the Small Business Innovative Research Program. Finally, David Sadlak's team developed a compact and inexpensive waste treatment system, making great progress in water treatment. All of this can be found on the website associated with the Berkeley 30-year anniversary and counting history. Next slide, please. All right. So now we get to some of the things that Martyn actually did. Okay. Over the three decades, Martyn has studied the effects of benzene on blood and bone marrow cancers, including leukemia and lymphoma. In the early days of the center, Eastman, Irons, and Smith reported in 1987, sorry, it does date you, that benzene metabolites cause synergistic bone marrow toxicity. A few years later, they revealed blood and bone marrow disorders occurred at exposure levels below the occupational safety standard at the time in 2004. They developed and applied biological markers of benzene exposure, providing a more detailed understanding of how benzene causes leukemia. Their research informed decisions by the US EPA to lower benzene content of gasoline in 2011. And the UC Berkeley SRP Center continues to systematically explore benzene exposure and biomarker relationships to understand the underlying mechanism by which benzene alters genes and damages cells, leading to cancer. Next slide, please. All right. So these are the 10 characteristics. So I actually had a lot of fun putting this together. The decades of risk assessment expertise provided by UC Berkeley served as a springboard for the development of the quote-unquote key characteristics approach to help risk assessors predict the toxicity of chemicals. Researchers defined 10 key characteristics, hard words to say, shared by cancer-causing chemicals and demonstrated how they could be used to organize data on mechanisms and inform decision-making. And they didn't stop there. Decided to expand the approach to other potential hazards. They worked with Cal EPA and the international researchers to identify key characteristics of chemicals that are potentially toxic to male and female reproduction. In collaboration with UC Davis and the University of Massachusetts Amherst, they evaluated mechanistic data and developed 10 key characteristics of endocrine disrupting chemicals that mimic or interfere with hormones in the body. These efforts are informing decision makers. IARC, the International Agency for Research on Cancer, has successfully used the key characteristics approach since 2015 to evaluate more than 50 different chemicals, and other agencies worldwide are beginning to apply it. The approach is being used by EPA's Integrated Risk Information System program and by Cal EPA to inform decisions. This is significant, okay? Similarly, the pharmaceutical industry is interested in key characteristics as a way to reduce animal testing. Consulting groups have also used a method to evaluate mechanistic data on the carcinogenicity of sucralose, aspartamine, and PFAS. And if you don't know about PFAS, you should know about PFAS. Anyway, that's what I want to say. And my last slide is just a general thank you. And Martyn, we follow each other on Instagram, and so let's keep in touch. And I'm looking forward to the net. Well, I probably won't be around for the next 35 years, but I'm looking forward to the Berkeley program continuing its outstanding efforts over time. Again, Martyn, thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you for that summary. That was great. And good luck with the wedding.
Okay. Thank you.